Then it was time to go to Wardenclyffe. But by then, by 1990, I had that all figured out.
That's the Tesla's idea. The receiver runs off the transmitter. It doesn't require any source of power. And the signal doesn't fade. And it doesn't weaken with distance.
It's inherent in electricity to free everything. They want to get rid of all radio.
Why?
It's too free.
But obviously, the people that invented the whole thing had a different idea how it was supposed to be implemented. Tesla, Steinmetz, all those people. And all that, everybody was horrified by what happened to their inventions.
The more I experimented with this lost science, the more one name kept coming up over and over again. Eric Dollard was the only one to recreate Tesla's key experiments with a new type of electricity. While everyone else never took Tesla past Frankenstein movies and Halloween parties, Eric Dollard had re-engineered the Tesla coils and written papers and equations. They worked. Where was Eric Dollard? What was he up to? How far had he gone? The good news, Eric was still alive and publishing. The bad news, Eric had all his labs taken from him and was living out of his car in the Mojave Desert. Time for action. Eric would not meet the same fate as Tesla. Not on my watch.
You're afraid of its potential.
Potential?
Yeah. It's inherent in electricity to free everything.
Free everything.
Do. They want to get rid of all radio.
Why?
It's too free.
Too free.
Yeah. You can't, it's too hard to regulate, particularly high-frequency radio. Anybody, you know, with a PRC-47 like in my car can, you know, talk to anybody in the world.
But RCA wanted a new system, and that's what it would turn out to be. Long after RCA died, that's what it turned out to be. I didn't know that then, and they didn't know that then. I was just the most likely guy to figure out something new. They already knew from supporting my high school experiments and letting me use the station for my own purposes. They knew that I was the guy that was going to come up with something new out of all the old junk. Because I was already doing stuff in the laboratory that nobody could even explain. I didn't know. They didn't know. Nobody knew what it was going to be. I don't even know who Tesla was, nor did they.
And it was time to go to Wardenclyffe. That's what RCA wanted in the beginning anyway. But by then, by 1990, I had that all figured out.
You had Wardenclyffe all figured out in 1990?
Yeah. I was ready to implement it. And that was the place to do it, and that's what the states, that's what KPH needed. Needed a new way to talk to ships at sea.
Using Tesla technology.
Using Tesla technology. Or Alex Anderson, or both.
Or improved.
Or improved, yeah.
And that's what Mr.
So I was going to start with the basic, Tesla transformer. I have built an experimental model. I was all ready for the first test of the receiving station up to Point Reyes. They were laughing about, the Eric's going to transmit to the through the ground to the receiving station. The station manager was anxiously waiting. And I showed the test of the transformer, and its ability, it's a light fluorescent lamps that, without any power loss. That kind of blew the transmitter tech away. The amp meter showed it was definitely transmitting in the station ground. I had a little RF milliamp meter, and it was putting, there's current going in the station ground. So the thing was to do it outside the shielded room of the station and do it out on the Alex Anderson antenna thing, and then have the guys up at the receiving station see what level they picked it up. And then go down to 500 kilocycles and do it to ships at sea.
Did you get a chance to finish this?
No, MCI boarded the station and tried to wreck it.
It was for ship to shore.
Ship to shore.
Ship to shore.
Can't they communicate now with ship?
Yeah, but this doesn't have the delay or the attenuation.
So how would it improve in performance?
Yeah, and the receiver would run off the transmitter.
Okay, so
That's the Tesla's idea. The receiver runs off the transmitter. It doesn't require any source of power. And the signal doesn't fade. And it doesn't weaken with distance.
So it didn't require any.
It would work anywhere in the Pacific. And there'd be, though, but the way that place is geologically set up and the grounds that are already there in the Tesla system, I expect the signal would be just as strong in China as it was off the coast of San Francisco. And there probably would be no time delay, or the time delay would be much less than the propagation of light.
So it would significantly improve this.
Because that's the ground terminal into the Earth. It was selected for that by Marconi. That's the Indians call it the hole in the sky. They went there and electrified them, and then they ran away from it. They wouldn't live there.
It was sacred to them.
Yeah, it's kind of like a ley line runs through there. The whole geology around there concentrates on this spot. It's like all the trees are lined up with it, and everything focuses on where that building sits. Wow. So according to the Marconi guys, there was 5 energy spots on the planet that were originally selected to try to build a global system, and Bolinas was one of the most important ones.
Talk the ships at sea? Doesn't sound too exciting, and can't we already do that? What does this have to do with Wardenclyffe? Wardenclyffe was a project to transmit electricity and radio with minimal losses over vast distances through the Earth and the ocean. What the ever modest and cautious Eric Dollard is doing by talking about ships at sea is offering his version of Wardenclyffe as a service to the U.S. Navy while not incurring the wrath of the oil companies. There's a reason Eric Dollard has stayed alive this long. Eric Dollard's version of Wardenclyffe is even more advanced than Nikola Tesla's, as it will allow the sending of radio and electricity at faster than light speeds through the Earth to any point on the Earth or sea with absolutely no losses. By placing it on a powerful ley line, like at Bolinas KPH, it will even synthesize and magnify the energy on the way, exceeding even what Tesla had imagined. Not bad for an old guy living in the desert.
Came up with something new that nobody, not Alex Anderson or Tesla, had ever come up with. I raised it to the next level. I was able to make it broadband. It was a general laboratory and facility in antenna-type communications of all different forms, all different frequencies, from microwaves all the way down to audio. The whole idea was to have the broadest, most generalized receiving capability possible. In other words, the ultimate receiver. Two days before they happened.
What percentage?
It worked twice for 2 earthquakes.
Which one?
Northridge and Landers. I got the same thing from Japan 2 days before the giant Japan earthquake.
Fukushima.
Yeah, I picked it all the way up in Landers. 1 hour before the first earthquake, and that was about 2 days before the main event. Oh, it'd just go wild.
How did it sound?
Well, different signals, different places seem different sounds. Here it was the sound of screaming sounds. First it starts with ricocheting bullets, and then they get snappier or more like steel wires being hit, and then they get stronger until eventually it's like whole dumpster loads of beer bottles being dumped on metal decks of ships or something, smashing. And it just builds up a sharper and sharper pitch until eventually the thing basically just shrieks. It's like almost like a sine wave. That's about 12 hours before the blast.
The blast?
Yeah, 6.5 or greater earthquake. At the Alex Anderson received from the interior of the Earth. And then there was what's called a Beveridge antenna. That's another RCA inventor, Beveridge. was an overground antenna that received from the ionosphere. And then the whole system was stereo. So on the audition system, the right-hand channel was underground and the left-hand channel was overground. So you could pick up stereo in two different dimensions. It all depends what's going on. Lightning storms or, you know, earthquakes, tornadoes, solar flares. The musical sounds come from inside the earth. Otherwise, you have to drill that hole. You have to drill a 100-foot deep hole, and then you have to make an electrolytic electrode to go down that hole and make contact with the soil around it. And you could never do it as good as a plant can, because that's the whole plant's way of life. It's grounding. In fact, I have a whole description of the system on the internet. It's called System for the Transmission and Reception of Telluric Electric Waves. It's about 20 pages. Gives a complete description of my whole telluric ionospheric transmission concept in the form of a patent statement.
So you willingly gave it to the public because you
want
this mission to
know. Yeah, well, good luck letting them figure it out.
Not one book. That's what that capitalist mentality does. It causes these people to hoard their stuff off in the corner, you know, and just spit at everybody. And not tell anybody what's going on, then it all gets lost. You know, Steinmetz was the other way around. They would force him not to write things in his book. Well, Steinmetz is the hero.
Describe him.
He's
physically?
The guy. He's a deformed, a hunchback dwarf.
Like Igor from Frankenstein.
Igor from Frankenstein. Yeah.
Was Igor actually based on him?
Yeah, that was Steinmetz.
And who was Dr. Frankenstein?
Tesla. To convince people of the horrors of electricity. It was kind of holdover from, you know, the Edison electrocuting circus animal days.
What was the Frankenstein monster? Who was he?
Well, I don't know. That's present-day technology. He took all the crap out of the mathematics. He de-euroed it. And they didn't like him for that.
So any engineer could understand.
Yeah, that was the whole idea.
And it was like...
And that's how Alexanderson came about. Alexanderson immigrated all the way from Sweden just to work with Steinmetz when he was 18 years old.
Another electrical engineer.
He's the guy that invented all that stuff at RCA, the radio frequency stuff, the Alexanderson antenna. There's no mathematical analysis available for any of this stuff. There's no way to express it analytically.
But I
came up with a way to do it out of Steinmetz's method.
What do you call your method?
It's called the Verser method.
Yeah. What was Steinmetz's
called? And everything has to be expressed in four terms rather than two.
Ah.
That's the problem, because you can't solve an algebraic expression higher than the second degree. And mine were all fourth and eighth. This stuff takes a long time to put together.
45 years?
All by myself. With all broken equipment pulled out of junkyards.
While working another job.
Well, and I had to pay for it. On top of that.
And you did it.
Yeah. And then somebody fucked it all up when it was done.
We're going to fix that, Mr. Dollar.
Yeah, well, good luck. But then they threw me out of the house, so what good was it to have the laboratory there? So, you know, it all got taken apart and never got put together again.
So then RCA started providing the bigger stuff, and then I built the big laboratory in San Francisco, and then about the time that was done, it got destroyed.
By who?
By the real estate swines. They raised the rent from 8 cents a square foot to a dollar a square foot when Feinstein became mayor.
Ah, raising the rent, that's the Olaf's way.
Right. And then they send the hoodlums in to smash and steal all your stuff, and the police don't do anything about it.
That was your second lab?
That was my first outside my parents' lab.
Okay, so it was your second real lab.
Yeah.
So I
tried to reconfigure, you know, a number of other places, and all the equipment got looted and disappeared, no matter where I moved it, and then Commonweal smashed the rest of it out at RCA. So I moved to Sonoma State, and after 4 years, it was the same thing. The administration changed, and they closed the radio station down and everything, and all the equipment was, all those RCA receivers and all that stuff was lost forever. All the RCA books, the original papers by their scientists, and everything was all lost. It's like that.
How many years
ago? So then I get in the Marconi building and put a whole thing back together again with David, you know, starting out of his bedroom, and that took damn near a year to put together, and when it was done, then the doors were slammed on me, and the equipment all disappeared, and that was all lost.
What number of lab was that, third or fourth?
Oh, I don't know. There's just, you know, there's all the little ones in between, too.
They were all lost.
Yeah, or whatever, you know, car or ship or whatever other thing. It's all, everything's all gone. All of it.
Well, I'm always alone. I'm in solitary confinement here. There's no people in my life. I'm here in solitary confinement in infinity with nothing to do in my car.
You know, I go back to the old Hollywood movies and I see the horse, you know, with the guy sitting on the idyllic scene exactly where my car is parked while I'm watching the movie downtown. It gives you another feeling about the place you live when you see it in all these Hollywood Western movies, you know, and they're portraying your rat hole as, you know, the idyllic scene when man conquered the West, you know, with the chorus in the background and the whole thing, and that happens to be your rat hole where you live.
I was in grammar school.
Oh, that was
one day a year. It was Eric Day.
At your grammar school?
Yeah. And then I'd drag whatever monstrosity I'd contrived at home, and then the school janitor would have to come and certify that it was safe to plug into the wall outlet. You know, he didn't have a clue.
Oh,
and
then
the bully got to get shocked. The teacher would force it to happen and make a mockery out of him in front of the entire class, and then the rest of the year he wasn't a bully.
And how many
volts?
He was
the guy that would get bit.
How many kilowatt hours?
Well, you know, I made sure to keep it, you know, less than like 5 milliamps or, you know, 10. Just, you know, about like getting slugged by a baseball bat, but it's not nothing to really, you know, do any damage to your body. It scares you more than anything.
I don't know my right from left. I can't tie my shoelaces.
So sucks.
Yeah, so they have the captain's inspection. Of course, I fail. You know, so the captain curses me and the whole thing, and I'm thrown out of line and all that. Well, that's fine. So I go back to work in the building. The executive officer is a Marine Corps. He's a lieutenant colonel. And they're nasty. So I try to go back in the building. And he stands in front of me. And he looks at me and he says, "Dollard, you are a slob." And then he goes, "But you do such damn good work, get back inside."
My thing is to try to get all this to get back together as fast as possible. I don't like being without it. How's that going to happen?
It's going to happen, God willing. The people get behind you if they know what you're trying to do and why it's important.
Why should they be interested in it?
Maybe they have dreams too, just like you. You know, we have dream empathy. When people we like and admire have dreams similar to ours that could help ours, we want to help them.
We'll see.
Ever pessimistic Mr. Dollard, except when he has to build something, then he knows it's going to work. But not much belief in his fellow humans. Can we prove him wrong?
With what?
Eric Dollard is the last link we have to a lost age of science, an age that began in ancient Egypt, flourished in Greece among Pythagoras, was exemplified in the cosmology of Kepler, the music of Bach, taken through its experimental pinnacle by Nikola Tesla, and made into reality by the math of Steinmetz. The entire technological world we now live in is a highly degraded form of what this technology was intended to be, a technology that is more ancient than you, and more natural than technology at all. Nikola Tesla ended his days impoverished and died alone in his hotel room, only to have the truth about his work suppressed, even today. The very same forces that banished Tesla are doing the same thing now to Eric Dollard. They have exiled him to solitary confinement in the desert. They have destroyed all his laboratories, and with them, 45 years of his work. Yet, they have not broken his spirit, nor will they, for he is made of far sterner stuff. This time, it is going to be different. We are a dedicated group of scientists, engineers, and believers in the power of the human spirit. We need you to join us in our quest to bring this great gift to humanity, a gift that will change all the rules. Every great wizard needs warriors to protect him while working his magic. This means you.